Professor Dave here. Let's talk strategy.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In our journey through calculus, we started with differentiation because it's quite simple and straightforward. We learned the power rule to take the derivative of a polynomial, and then we learned the sum and difference rules, product and quotient rules, and then the chain rule. From these, we found that we could take the derivative of just about anything, and even if it got a little messy, there was no question as to how to go about doing it. We just have to do the work. Integration doesn't work like this, unfortunately. There is no rigid algorithm to follow. We sometimes have to look at an integrand and come up with a strategy for integration. And this strategy could involve one of the techniques we have discussed, or something different still. This is what makes integration so difficult, but also so exciting. It's like a sport. There is no guaranteed way to win. You just have to learn as many tips, tricks, and methods as you can. Practice a lot, and over time you will become more and more adept. If you haven't watched my tutorials that go over the substitution rule, integration by parts, and trigonometric substitution, go back a bit in the series and check those out now, as in this clip, we will assume that these methods are already understood. If you're all caught up, let's go ahead and use this opportunity to synthesize everything we've learned about integration so far. We will look at some examples where it's not immediately obvious what approach will be the one to use, but we will talk through the logic that should be employed in order to get to the answer. First things first, it will either be the case that you have access to a table of integration formulas, or we will have to memorize as many of them as possible. Either way, we will need a table like this to refer to while determining a strategy for integration. In this table, we can see the formula that allows us to integrate each term in a polynomial, followed by all of the special formulas we should know. For example, we must recall that the integral of 1 over x is the natural log of x. Then there is one for an exponential function. Then all of the trigonometric functions. These are useful because if we can get an integrand to look like something we see here, we will probably have an easy time integrating. But we may need to do some substitution to get there. We will also want to memorize, or at least be able to recognize, the formulas that allow us to perform integration by parts, as well as trigonometric substitution. Armed with all of this, let's see what we can do. All right, let's give this first one a shot. How about the integral of x over root x squared plus 4 dx? We immediately recognize that this is too complicated to be integrated directly, so we need to use one of our techniques. With this example, we will learn right away that sometimes multiple techniques could be applied. We could be tempted to use trigonometric substitution, noticing that this radical expression allows it. We absolutely can use this technique. However, we might also notice that direct substitution will be much easier, since we see that there is an expression for which a form of its derivative is also present. If we take u to equal x squared plus 4, this part becomes root u. And then du will equal 2x dx. We have x dx, so that's no problem. We can just rearrange slightly to make x dx equal to du over 2. Plug that in, and we are left with du over 2 root u. If we modify slightly, we can pull 1/2 out of the integral, change the root u in the denominator into u to the negative 1/2, and now things look nice and easy. U to the negative 1/2 becomes u to the 1/2 over 1/2, or 2 u to the 1/2 plus c. The 2's cancel, u to the 1/2 is simply root u, and we change u back to the other form. This leaves us with a nice and tidy answer, root x squared plus 4 plus c. So as we just saw, there may be more than one path to an answer, and it's not a big deal if you end up taking a route with a couple extra steps, provided you still arrive at the correct answer. And in fact, you can always check that your answer is correct by taking its derivative and verifying that the result is equivalent to the integrand, which means you can walk out at the end of your integration exam already knowing that you got 100%. But to summarize the lesson learned from this example we just completed, we should carefully note that apart from basic situations where simplifying the integrand will allow it to be integrated, like distributing something across a sum or difference, expressing roots as fractional exponents, or applying trig identities, it is the case that direct substitution will usually be the easiest technique if a special technique must be applied. So it may be a good strategy to check if this is possible first, and only if it isn't should you then see which of the other two techniques might apply. How about this one? The integral of cotangent x times the natural log of sine x dx. This is a product of functions, so integration by parts may come to mind. But remember, let's first check to see if one of these functions is the derivative of the other. Cotangent is cosine over sine. That would require the quotient rule. Maybe we could try that if we get to that point, but how about the other function? This derivative will require the chain rule. The derivative of natural log of sine of x will involve the derivative of natural log first, which is 1 over whatever it's operating on, so we get 1 over sine x. Then we multiply by the derivative of the inner function, and the derivative of sine is cosine, so we get cosine x over sine x. Well, that is cotangent, so substitution should work out perfectly here. We make ln sine x equal to u, and then we find that cotangent x dx is equal to du. That will give us u du. We integrate to get 1/2 u squared, switch u back to what it was before, and then finish things off with plus c. Easier than you expected, I bet. Let's try another. How about the integral of cosine root x dx? This seems like it could be straightforward, but it's possible that no strategy jumps out at you immediately. When in doubt, try substitution. Here, the most obvious thing to do is to make u equal to root x. That way, we no longer have a composite function. And if u will be root x, we need to get du. Well, du over dx will be the derivative of x to the 1/2, and that's 1/2 times x to the 1/2 minus 1, or negative 1/2. The negative means we put it on the bottom of a fraction, and 1/2 means square root, so du over dx is 1 over 2 root x. Now, normally we would bring dx up here, and then we would look for 1 over 2 root x dx in the integrand so that we could replace it with du. That's how the substitution method typically works. Unfortunately, we don't see that in the integrand, but here's another trick. If you're trying substitution and you don't see g prime x dx in the integrand, try solving for dx instead. Here, that will be 2 root x du. So let's replace dx with this expression. It may be the case that the terms with x in them cancel out any remaining x terms in the integrand, which will solve our problem. Or, failing that, they may be terms that can also be expressed in terms of u. In this case, u is root x, and we have a root x here, so why not just change that to u instead? Now we can pull the 2 out, and we are left with the integral of cosine u times u du. This is something that can very easily be integrated by parts. So let's put a box around this to mark our progress, as we don't want to get lost. And once we solve this integral, we can come back to where we were. Now, when we integrate by parts, we assign a u and a dv, and then find du and v. Here, we have u's already, so in order to avoid confusion, let's change this to some other variable, like z. So now we have cosine z times z dz. Now let's integrate by parts. Remember, we pick a function for u that, when in the form of du in the new integral, will make it much easier to integrate, so that should definitely be z, because that will become 1. So u equals z, and dv equals cosine z dz. That means du is simply dz, and v is sine z, since sine is the integral of cosine. Now we use the formula. The first integral is equal to uv, which is z sine z, minus the integral of v du, which is sine z dz. The integral of sine is negative cosine, so the negatives cancel, leaving us with z sine z plus cosine z plus c. Now that we are all done with the integration, we are safe to return the z's back to u's, because we only changed them so that we could use the integration by parts method without confusion. So that's now u sine u plus cosine u plus c. Let's also recall that when we did the original substitution, we arrived at 2 times this integral, which we then integrated by parts. So we have to bring back the 2 now, since we are done integrating. Now we just remember that we initially used u to represent root x, so let's bring back root x, and we get 2 times this quantity. Then we just distribute to get 2 root x sine root x plus 2 cosine root x plus c. So that may seem like it was terribly complicated in retrospect, and our answer does look far more complex than the integrand. But that's the answer, and all we really did to get there was a simple substitution followed by integration by parts. So let's take a breath here. We've seen that sometimes it's best to just try a substitution and see what happens. It may go as planned, or we may get to something else that can be integrated by parts. This is because integration by parts requires a product of functions in the integrand, and this approach works best when one function is a power of x or a polynomial, and the other is some transcendental function, like a trig function or an exponential or logarithmic function. And we can assign u and dv according to the strategy we described when we learned this technique. Sometimes, as we just saw, we need to do some kind of substitution first in order to get things to a place where integrating by parts makes sense. And if that's the case, then that's just what we have to do. Sometimes the substitution isn't obvious, so just try something. If it doesn't work, try something else. Unfortunately, there will indeed be cases when even these techniques don't apply, and if so, we have to be clever and try something else. Sometimes we have to manipulate the integrand in a particular way. Take something like the integral of dx over 1 minus cosine x. None of our techniques will work here, but with a difference in the denominator, we might be able to think of something else to try. We know that we can simplify a sum or difference in the denominator of a fraction by multiplying by its conjugate. So what if we multiply by 1 plus cosine x over 1 plus cosine x? Remember that this is useful because then on the bottom, when we FOIL, we get 1 plus cosine minus cosine squared. So the cosine terms cancel. With squared trig functions, an identity can usually be used. And in fact, 1 minus cosine squared is indeed sine squared. This was useful because with a single term in the denominator, we can now split this up into simpler fractions. 1 over sine squared is cosecant squared. And the other fraction can remain as cosine over sine squared. This can be split up into 2 integrals, the first of which is easy to integrate, because cosecant squared simply becomes negative cotangent. Then with the other one, it is fairly easy to spot that substitution will be our best approach. If we put u in place of sine x, we get u squared on the bottom, and du will be cosine x dx, which we have here. So du over u squared, or u to the negative 2 du. This becomes negative 1 over u, or negative 1 over sine x, which is cosecant x. So we end up with negative cotangent x minus cosecant x plus c. We have learned a lot about integration over the past few tutorials. We learned what it means, how to do it, and a few tricks for when it becomes more complicated. Sometimes we have to substitute twice. Sometimes we have to substitute and then integrate by parts, or vice versa. With practice, you will only become better and better at the art of integration, and you will be able to apply ingenuity to figure out an appropriate strategy, allowing you to integrate expressions you've never even seen before. We will now be moving on to other concepts involving integration, but first, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.